This video has been sponsored by The Great Courses Plus. It's a service where you have instantaneous access to lectures by top professors. One of these lectures inspired the creation of this video, so stay tuned till the end of the video to find out more. It's 10 o'clock p.m. You sit motionless at home, just one more episode. But wait, you hunger. You need sustenance, fuel. In a blur, you sprint to the kitchen. Your worst fears are confirmed. All your food, it's gone. What do you do? I'll tell you what you do. You get in your car and drive 500 feet to the nearest burger joint and order a greasy, fat-throbbing meal. Within 5 minutes of your culinary struggle, you are back at home watching Frasier once more. This is not a dream. This is reality. You see, we live in a society in which one can access nutrients with relative ease in a minimalist time frame. In many circles, this is referred to as fast food. We accept this world, and the rules which guide it. But how did it come to be, this seemingly utopian state of Big Macs and Whoppers? Today, we delve into the unknown. In an era before fast food, acquiring these bastions of caloric intake was rather difficult. Food could be acquired through various means, none particularly pleasant. You could purchase food from a local merchant, albeit unprepared. This would result in the consumer taking part in the act of cooking, often requiring third-party accessories. Alternatively, one could hunt wild game in the great outdoors. The noble buffalo, once alive, now awaits its delicious fate as your appetizer. Some skilled workers could go as far as to plant various beans and seeds that would potentially sprout crop. This produce would then be consumed or sold for profit. But you cannot stop progress, and science gave us the luxury of speed. No, not cars, not yet. But we had fish and we had chips. This nautical-themed delicacy of the British Isles was the first fast food. Indeed, as early as the 19th century, customers could order and receive fried things relatively quickly, limitations withstanding. The primary limitation? Transportation. In this day, your horse was your car, and your horse could get tired. Luckily, science would come around again, this time adding engines to our previously tired horses. The advent of the car allowed a new type of restaurant. A lucky car owner could drive to a parking lot, at which a waiter slash waitress would attend to them. They would order from a selection of meals, and after 20 or so minutes, would have said meal delivered to them, to be consumed in the car. This was just what we needed in this fast-paced 20th century world, but it was only the beginning of something much bigger. It was here, at White Castle, that the world really changes forever. They implement an assembly line within the production of their food. With multiple people working on one specific job, your wait time would be cut from 20 minutes to a minute or less. This was truly fast food. With its success, opened more locations, and each location maintained a basic style. Branding. They looked similar, had a similar menu, same ingredients. If you went to one, you knew what the rest would be like. Of course, this was exactly what the public wanted, dare I say, needed. More locations, and even different chains from similar-minded entrepreneurs. However, it was quickly apparent that this idea was too grand for one single person to manage. How could a single company even manage thousands of locations? To solve this problem, the chain A&W introduces franchising. In this agreement, a third party opens and runs a restaurant with the name, branding, ingredients, and the rules of the corporation it franchises from. Profits are shared, everybody is happy. This leads to the potential of much more explosive growth than previously conceived. With this influx of locations, fast food begins to deal with a new set of problems. With uniform ingredients comes a lot of shipping. Better ingredients, even just slightly better, costs a bit more. And when you're serving millions a day, that bit starts to add up. So quality becomes second rate. Speed, convenience, and price is the three pillars of fast food success. It works. Kinda. Over the course of the 20th century, it becomes easier for many to access fast food than conventional food. Now, certain, effects occur with the increased consumption of high-fat, carb-loaded, grease things. The consumer may find themselves gaining mass, or simply buying larger clothes. You'll lose that weight eventually, Jimmy. And as such, a new craze starts. Consumers demand a healthy alternative. With this comes the rise of a new type of fast food, the fast casual. Increased prices, potentially longer waits, but higher quality, less obesity-causing foods. Think Chipotle or something else like that. Fast food has been hurt. Interest decreases. In response, they commit to fixing their image problem. Offer salads, tea, maybe cut some fat or whatever. Even better, drop prices. What a world. So eventually, the world reaches equilibrium. Fast food, fast casual living in harmony, building a better future. I'm just kidding. It's all garbage. This video was inspired by a lecture which was featured in the video service The Great Courses Plus. World War II and the Advent of Fast Food by Professor Ken Albala. Here he discusses the correlation between World War II and the advent of fast food. You can access this and many numerous courses through The Great Courses Plus. It's a subscription, on-demand video learning service with over 10,000 lectures to choose from. Topics like science, history, math, and really specific odd topics that continue to be updated, like photography. Courses are sometimes even hosted by National Geographic and the Smithsonian. Much like Cody, I don't like college because of the grades. This is a great alternative by removing the pressure of failure. Just watch and listen. So if you want to learn more about fast food and whatnot, click on this link to get 1 month of unlimited access to courses and videos absolutely free. Just visit thegreatcoursesplus.com/knowledge. The link is provided in the description below. This is Tyler of Knowledge Hub.